Majora Carter, our new moderator for the second panel. And if all the panelists could come up, that'd be great.
Awesome. All right. So holla if you love the Bronx. Yeah. You can do a little better than that, folks. That's all right. So while we assemble this highly esteemed panel, thank you all for doing this. And so while we're all set and getting ready, could I just ask everybody to stand up real quick? Just a little quick, real funny. Just to get a little bit of stretch going, because I'm feeling like there's a little lack of energy, and you got to do something to get it up. So just kind of like your shoulders, your neck. Roll your neck around a little bit. Both directions, please, and lift your hands up, and just like really just give yourself a little stretch, and turn and face your neighbor, and give him a hug. Ah, see? Notice how my panel's not particularly friendly. That's okay. I'm like standing up here all by myself. Huh? I shouldn't I? All right, now you can sit down and we can do the hookups later at G Bar. But in the meantime, no, really, I'm so excited to be here. And this particular panel is a bit of a labor of love and just the reason for being here as far as I'm concerned. So, I'm Majora Carter. I am the CEO of the Majora Carter Group. We've been doing urban revitalization strategies, you know, starting here in my hometown in the South Bronx, but working nationally as well. Holla. And I'm also a co-founder of Bronx Tech Meetup, and my illustrious co-founder is sitting back there, Tina's shoulder. So wave to everybody, Tina. Say hi. There you go. And I'm also a startup, social enterprise tech companies as well, called Startup Box, which you'll hear from a little bit today, but you know, I'm just excited about that as well. But anyway, we know that here in New York City, we're known worldwide as a place that's known as a melting pot or a mosaic, but in the tech world here, it is lacking sort of significantly in diversity. You know, overwhelmingly white, overwhelmingly male. I would certainly not be the default person one would think of when you think of a tech founder, right? That's okay, because that is actually not true. There's plenty of us out there. But, and also as a loud, proud daughter of the South Bronx, crazy hearing about it is that, you know, one of the first descriptors that come out of most folks' mouth when they write or think about it is that, you know, part of it is one of the poorest congressional districts in the country, full stop, as if that will define us for the rest of their life. And, you know, as the borough president was saying, definitely this place is very different from the 70s and 80s burning Bronx that we grew up in. Lots of things, amazing things have changed here. And so again, being loud, proud, talented daughter of the South Bronx, no, we're not alone. So there is definitely great opportunities here. And so, but how do we ensure that Bronxites, you know, us as a borough, are given the opportunity to participate fully in the tech economy? How are we building and supporting tech talent in the pipeline level, but also to develop entrepreneurs? How are we building and attracting tech businesses? And so that they come to and see the Bronx as a great place to be. And how are we doing all this specifically as an economic development strategy for our borough, which will, of course, help all of New York City, but significantly support our communities and show exactly that New York City can actually have tech ecosystems that exist well above 30th Street and Brooklyn. We can do it here. Believe me, it can be done in the Bronx. It's already happening. So it gives me great, great pleasure to introduce this amazing panel that we have here today, because they're all doing it, each in one in their very own pipeline right here in the Boogie Down. And so first, I'm going to introduce each one of them here really quickly. And then they're going to have about 2 minutes each to talk about what it is they're doing. And then I'm going to ask one quick question, and then we're going to throw it open to the audience, okay? So you start thinking, you know, put your thinking caps on, and because they're all brilliant, believe me. So first, we have Keith Klain, who's the CEO, co-CEO of Doran Jones, a New York-based consulting company building a technology outsourcing center in the South Bronx. And for the last 20 years, Keith has built technology teams for global financial services and IT consulting firms in the US, UK, and Asia Pacific. Keith designed the software testing education program with the Bronx-based nonprofit for Scholas while he was a director at Barclays Investment Bank. He's the executive vice president of the Associate for Software Testing and was the recipient of the 2013 Software Test Professionals Luminary Award. So that is Keith right here. Then we've got, who's next? Oh, James Chase. James Pray Chase as president of Startup Box. James uses his experience in the New York's media, communications, and marketing industries to discover new clients for the B2B services that allow Startup Box to employ people in the South Bronx today. The entry-level jobs he's responsible for are platforms for career building, as well as valuable cash flows into communities from which technology only takes money out. Angie Kamath is from Piscolas, training into job creation. Who's next? Oh, Alex, there you go. Alex Abelin is the co-founder and CEO of LiquidTalent, a new generation job platform modernizing the way professionals discover, connect, and work together. Prior to starting LiquidTalent, Alex spent 7+ years at Google, spending time in 4 different offices, and was responsible for bringing free Google-sponsored Wi-Fi to Chelsea. Way to go. Cool.
And being my mentor.
Yes. And then we've got Varun Sehgal. Has been the Chief Information Officer and Assistant VP of Technology at Hostos Community College since 2006. He previously led global technology initiatives at Simpson, Thatcher, and Bartlett, and Capgemini, Ernst & Young, and is involved in numerous initiatives around workforce development for technology sector skills and jobs. And then we've got William Floyd, Head of External Affairs for Google New York. Okay, so give them all a round of applause here. Everyone, we're going to take it from there. And so I'm going to start just again with real quick questions for them. They'll have some time to answer, and then we're going to throw it off. And also for you guys, if there's something you kind of want to jump in on, please feel free. So this is like a sort of a chatty group of people, and they've all got awesome things to say. So for Angie, your first question. So there is sort of this well-documented trend that unconscious hiring biases play a big role in the lack of diversity in the tech field. What are you doing to address that or deal with that for Piscolas grads?
Sure, thanks. So at Piscolas, something that we're very, very passionate about is thinking about diversity. And it's really interesting because I think the idea of the skills gap comes up a lot, and you hear about so many thousands of jobs that are unfilled and such high unemployment. But I don't actually really believe in the skills gap. I actually think it's about hiring bias. I think there's a lot of folks out there who can get those jobs, but they're not diverse. They're not the folks that we care about, and really highlight the good work that Google has done to shine a spotlight on where they're at, what it looks like, and what we can do. And so what we do at Piscolas, about a year and a half ago, and we've been around for 20 years, but about a year and a half ago, we launched a corporate volunteer program. And so we work with about 400 or 500 corporate volunteers a year, and the idea is, let's bring them up to the Bronx. Let's demystify what the Bronx is all about, to Majora's point earlier. Let's demystify what diverse talent pipelines are. Let's demystify what it means to maybe not have a college degree but have a high school diploma and some college. Let's really take apart what it means to have what it means to be a tech worker. And that's really, really important. And I think that's where kind of bias and breaking down those myths is what we do. We also look a lot at just changing up employer hiring practices. And so one of the most vivid examples recently is one of our employers, very big employer, I will not name them, but they had a really rigid hiring process. And so part of that process was answering an online assessment with these deductive reasoning questions. So those classic questions of two cars coming from different directions. One's at 30 miles an hour, one's at 55, when do they meet? I cannot answer that, and I have 2 Ivy League degrees. I'm not going to expect, our students or really anyone, normal to answer that one. And so most of our students were failing that, but they were amazing, certified, great technicians. And so what we worked with that employer is we got them to change up that process. We got them to show our students, to prepare them for that interview set of questions. We got them to move those set of questions further down the interview process so that our folks, our diverse talent, could have a fighting shot at a skills-based job. And so that's what we do, and I have to highlight that we've got a bunch of awesome Piscolas grads out in the audience, and you can see for yourself the wide diversity that they represent, but the talent that they do as well.
Now,
I just wanted to jump in.
Sure.
Because you spoke about unconscious bias, and that's something that Google is very aware of, ironically. As Angie mentioned, we were the first company in the tech sector to reveal our diversity numbers, and we were woefully lacking in a number of areas. So we started to do a lot of deep thinking and self-assessment on our own part, and instituted a program on unconscious bias. So first off, you know, bring the unconscious to light, mm-hmm. and acknowledge how we all have our own innate biases that we apply without even knowing when it comes to hiring folks. And then the second thing is then acting on it. So, mm-hmm. you know, figuring out how do we, you know, broaden our talent pool, how can we change the way that we go and assess that talent, and then most importantly, creating an environment where culturally diverse people can feel like they can coexist. Or like we like to say, you know, you can wave your Google freak flag here anywhere you want to. But those are really important things, and I think we all need to be active participants in unconscious bias.
Okay, I want to pick up on something there, because probably up until the last year and a half of my life, I've been the kind of, I guess, hidden face of hiring bias, working in the corporate world, particularly for investment banks and technology for the last 20 years. I don't think it's quite, not being an apologist, but it's not quite as simple as unconscious hiring bias. I think in, you know, working very closely with Proskolis and the folks there, it's a lot to do with access as well. Mm-hmm. So having been in, I created the program with Proskolis while I was at Barclays, I had no idea the folks were there or that the training programs existed. And the structural barriers in corporate hiring, and I'm not talking about cool places like Google, I'm talking about not cool places like banks and insurance companies and who do the bulk of the hiring in technology. That's the lion's share of technology hiring doesn't exist at the cool companies, it's at the very decidedly unsexy companies, right?
True.
And you know, the ability for someone who had come through a Proskolis program or any other program to that resume to get on my desk, it was just literally impossible to get through all our university relationships, all our own hiring and corporate, and the relationships. Most of the people that I've hired probably in the last 10 years were a referral, and nobody coming through Proskolis knew who I was. So I think that's why I like the Proskolis program so much, is that they do focus on corporate partnerships, mm-hmm. and opening up those additional lanes of hiring that, frankly, the people there don't even know exist.
So I actually need to apologize. You were supposed to go down and give your 2-minute intro about who you are, which I totally forgot, because I really wanted to ask your questions. So you are more than free to do that, even though I think each one of you did a little bit of that already. But Angie, if you want the opportunity, you might as well take it. We do have time.
Can I say something? I cede my turn to James.
I want to get in on the hiring bias question.
It.
I think we basically are all introducing a lot of what our respective companies do through a hiring bias lens. And the fact that there's companies and that they can address that is a super good thing. Much of what was said in the previous panel can be thought of as a bias in terms of access and where it gets first also. And our company, Startup Box, is tiny compared to most of the folks who have been up here today. And we operate not in that, you know, tsunami of Googles and Verizons and big companies that are doing huge things. We're kind of surfing in that tube. We're in the trough of the wave right now. And that's where we've found a lot of strength. There's a lot of cool things you can do down there. With regard to hiring bias, our model is to do B2B tech services that are currently offshored, find the companies that are vulnerable to the losses that you get when you offshore. They're subtle, and there's not everybody who has those, but many do. And bring those jobs to the Bronx. And we put a minimum viable training package together so that we could hire as many people who come through the door. And one of the things that we found was way overqualified people were coming through the door than for what exactly we were hiring for in those jobs. So that's definitely an indication of a hiring bias. These were people who had tried and failed for various reasons. By being a B2B tech service, we assume hiring bias. We're too small to change it. We don't have the influence like a lot of other organizations do. But by being a B2B tech service, and we have our client's product in our home, in our lab, and our workers get a hold of it and treat it with great care and really give our company clients, rather, good feedback, now the people inside of our clients' companies know who they're talking to on the other end. It's not like you just press a button and send it to India or someplace. You send it to the Bronx. You can meet those people in the Bronx. Wow, you like them. You've got common interests. You see their reports coming in at 10 a.m. every day. You know they're on top of it. When the push comes to shove and they're looking for positions to fill, you might feel safer with somebody that you actually have created a no-risk working relationship with. And in the meantime, if you don't, we're still able to pay a decent wage to those folks to do the work anyhow. So the more clients we bring in, the more exposure, the more sort of Trojan horses that we make to get past the hiring bias without anybody even bringing up the word. That's Startup Box.
Okay, Alex.
Yeah. I'm happy to introduce LiquidTalent through a hiring bias lens. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Majora and James and William, pleasure to see you guys. You know, LiquidTalent, we're building a mobile and web-based platform to connect hires with talent. We believe the future of work is going to look a lot different than what today's workplace looks like. We believe that we're moving into a more independent, mobile, 1099 independent contractor model than we have today and yesterday, which is more of a W-2, Monday through Friday, 9-to-5 based model. And that's for a variety of reasons. I think two of the biggest drivers of this is, one is technology. We actually can now work anywhere from any time. That's not what it used to be. And the preferences have dramatically changed. Half of young people, 54% of millennials, want to start a company. It's a very entrepreneurial generation. They don't really subscribe to the same values as previous working generations, which is, I'm going to clock in, I'm going to clock out, I'm going to be there for 40 years, I'm going to get my gold watch, and I'm going to retire. That's not the working reality we live anymore. It's less profit interest, it's less profit focus, and it's more about aligning with your passions and your values.
In a job right now for young people, and
that's certainly not what it was before. So what we're building right now is a place where project-based work can flourish. Mm. We're building a platform at LiquidTalent that that hires can come into the platform in a peer-to-peer way and find talent that's vetted through their social networks. In 4 to 5 days rather than 4 to 5 weeks, right? Headhunting and recruiters generally charge 20 to 30% to make these placements. Right now we're charging 10% for the project-based fee. So it's a very exciting, mobile, fast, lifestyle-driven marketplace. We're building a community I liked what William said, is kind of waving their own freak flags. That's that definitely resonates. I come from Google. I spent almost 8 years at Google, and you know, when I left Google, I was looking for something like LiquidTalent. I was looking for a place where I could work independently and hang my hat as an independent professional. I didn't find it. It wasn't in TaskRabbit. It wasn't in LinkedIn. So I really decided to address my own problem and address those of others that I was seeing in my community and build this platform. In terms of a hiring bias and a hiring lens, we're leaning away from what college you graduated, we're leaning away from what your GPA was, what your SAT score was, and we're leaning into what you can actually do. Can you design? Mm. Can you code? Are you results driven? That's the stuff that I think employers and hires and jobs are looking for, are people that can get shit done. Right. It's not looking for someone that graduated from two Ivy Leagues and can't do arithmetic or whatever, you know.
Uh-oh. And you tell me the answer. You know it.
It's a very...
You make you feel bad.
Angie and I are friends now. And please make fun of me all you want as well. It's a very different market, and it's exciting. I'll leave it at that.
So I'll let Angie deal with you later. But in the meantime, Alex, I did want to ask you specifically, how do you see the LiquidTalent platform, which is pretty interesting. How do you think it's going to help support folks in the Bronx and why?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there's a few ways. You know, what we're seeing right now, so we've done 40 projects since we launched, and that was in October of 2013. We launched our beta product in May of 2014, and we've been able to do 40 projects that have totaled about $300,000 in value. Mm-hmm. We launched in July our V2 version, which we're really excited about, a whole new revamped look and feel. We've been active in recruiting partnerships that reflect underrepresented communities. I think that's first and foremost something that we really care greatly about. We've worked with Scholas. We've worked with Startup South Bronx. We're looking for organizations that are training this next wave of technical and creative talent. There's amazing boot camps that are popping up all over the place. There's online courses that are teaching this next wave of talent through Khan Academy, through General Assembly, through Codify. And it doesn't really matter where you live. It matters that you have a hunger and that you have what this previous panel was talking about, which is access to the internet, which is the ultimate kind of equalizer of gaining and accessing knowledge. For us, it's really about casting our net and marketing towards organizations that are doing that work in those locations. And it's something that we really care about. This is not a place for the traditional person to come on and thrive. We don't win at LiquidTalent, and I personally don't think the company is successful unless there is a flourishing, diverse marketplace of people from all walks of life. And it's something that's very much core to the company that we're building.
Cool. Very cool. I'm not going to make fun of you, I swear. I just want to let everyone in the audience know that Alex, LiquidTalent is one of the companies that is a client of Startup Box. So whenever LiquidTalent is successful, they hire Startup Box. Dollars that you guys are generating come literally into Hunts Point and into people who didn't have jobs or bank accounts before. So that's how he's impacting the box.
Cool. Thank you. So Varun, if you can speak a little bit about your role here at Scholas and particular, what did I say?
Scholas.
We're
going to
take over the world.
There you go. At Hostos. And also, I think you're really interesting on this panel in particular because you have the perspective of being what is an anchor institution that could play a huge role in supporting tech talent pipeline in a very interesting way. So I'd love to hear you talk about that.
Certainly. Thank you. So Hostos is an anchor institution. Now, my role here is the Chief Information Officer and AVP for Technology. And part of what makes Hostos unique is that this institution was born from the community, from the demands of this entire South Bronx area. And so when it was made, there was really a resurgence for how do we get this community to the next level? How do we bring the citizens of this community out of poverty? How do we get them to a place where they can better themselves, overcome some of the biases that existed over 50 years ago, but still carry on in certain, you know, dimensions? And now it's time for a second resurgence. I mean, Hostos, as an educational institution, as part of the City University of New York, our mission is to help all of those from diverse backgrounds get to a better place in their lives, and not only for themselves, but for future generations. Because we all know, studies show that every household that has someone with a college degree ends up influencing future generations and the society many full times over. And so what does Hostos do in the community? Well, besides, of course, providing education in some of the most advanced fields when it comes to allied health, digital design, we're one of the only organizations in the Bronx, which offers a digital game and digital design degree program. We were the first to offer that. Now other institutions, of course, are following suit. But we do a lot more. We reach out to all of the partner organizations. We've worked with Scholas in the past. I know Plinio very well. I worked with him on a grant many years ago. And we're also now trying to figure out, well, how do we create the talent pipeline in technology? The Bronx traditionally has not been looked at as a source for tech talent. Retail, services-based industries, and so forth, that's where the Bronx is. I mean, the mentality has been set such that, well, those are the jobs that we need to get into, so that's what we're going to train for, and those are the jobs that are available to us. But that's not true. The passion in this society and the skills that can be turned around in a very short time frame are so enormous that we've realized that through the development of a New York State apprenticeship program, which we've submitted a grant proposal for to be the first in the state to do so, we will be developing the pipeline not just for all of the organizations, but the bigger companies like Google, Startup Box, hopefully, LiquidTalent, and all of our other partner agencies, which can take this talent. And how are we going to get there? By working with them to determine what are the skills that you need. There is no sense in creating talent pools where the technology is either out of date or not in demand. We can create junior network administrators, but if all of those jobs are already taken, then what's the point? So if we need quality assurance testers, for example, or we need folks who know how to code mobile apps, that's where we're going to work very closely with our partner organizations to determine the need. What we do here at Hostos, we've created programs which incentivize the use of technology. We have a rewards points program where throughout the year, as students participate in technology-related workshops and so forth, they earn points. And in the spring, we hold a big bash where they all get technology products. Because besides, of course, having the infrastructure in place, I think our previous panelists mentioned, you need to have the endpoints. You need to have the laptops. You need to have the tablets. So we're working very closely within the organization and other organizations to determine how we get those endpoints to the users. We recently had a grant from the Verizon Foundation that helped us launch a technology student leadership boot camp. In 1 week, we took 8 students who had no background in technology, no background in video design, editing, or anything. And at the end of 5 days, they produced such an amazing piece of work using Macs, using Photoshop, and other software, we were blown away. So what that goes to show is that if the right guidance is available,
if the right support structures are in place, we can truly make a difference in these students' lives
and really help build that tech talent pipeline. I think the other area that we need to work very closely with in terms of our partners is the infrastructure service providers. What happens is, and this goes a little bit into both the digital divide as well as the hiring bias, a lot of individuals think that technology is too difficult, that we can't learn it, it's only for the geeks in Silicon Valley or Silicon Alley downtown, and it's an unsurmountable obstacle. It's not. We need to do a better job at bridging that gap between the perceptions as well as what they can and cannot do, and make it a can-do society here in the Bronx, because that's where we need to be. So part of what we think really needs to happen is that as a lot of our partner organizations develop their jobs, they need to develop them in a manner that allows our stay-at-home moms, our single parents, our folks who are taking care of their elderly parents here in the South Bronx with the access they need at home and not necessarily having to fear being away for long hours every day working in a location. That, I think, will go a long way in help bridging the issue where our Bronx native residents do not feel that they're ready to take on responsibility in the tech sector.
I love that your approach is not the very typical sort of train and pray approach to workforce development and job development that we often see in our borough and nationally, sadly. So I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
Now, I have a question for Keith. Now, you were, still are, a part of a company that did do a lot of urban, or rather that did do a lot of offshore work. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose the Bronx?
Well, we chose the Bronx because the original idea, so what we're doing basically is the company that I joined and started up the software testing practice around is basically creating a cost-competitive alternative to offshoring. And so we've built out a 15,000-square-foot facility down on 138th Street, sharing the building with Scholas, to outsource testing and development jobs that ordinarily would be sent to India, Far East Asia, Eastern Europe, and working with my relationships and colleagues that I have in banking and telco and insurance industry to basically outsource those jobs to us. And right now we've got about 150 seat facility ready and then another 300 on top of that if we build out the third floor. The reason that I started working with Scholas was being introduced through our CIO at the time, who was on the Scholas board, was to create, I'd been living in Singapore for a couple years and spent a lot of time in India traveling and training folks there. And when I came out and met the people at the Scholas program, I was completely blown away at how talented and incredibly intelligent and a lot of initiative and all the stuff I was looking for everywhere else in the world was literally, you know, 20 minutes away from my office in Manhattan. So I pitched this idea to Barclays to then create it was just going to be a Barclays facility then. And as the, you know, banking sector, you know, does their, you know, biannual, we're out of money, cut all our IT budget, you know, dance. I pitched the idea to Scholas to basically join a startup and create as a separate business. I think so that was why I came here, really. I mean, because we're a for-profit business. Yeah. We have a partnership with Scholas. We do a profit share with them. You know, so there's that we've agreed to hire 80% of the folks that are going to be in the facility who have come through the program. So we've created a private-public partnership with them, but we're a for-profit business. And I just want to, you know, at the risk of sounding negative, but I think, you know, if you look at, there was a report that the mayor's office put out a year ago, I believe, and it was about the tech ecosystem in New York. Mm-hmm. And the amount of, so that they divided jobs into tech jobs at tech companies, tech jobs at non-tech companies, and non-tech jobs at tech companies. So tech jobs at tech companies is like being a developer at Google. A tech job at a non-tech company is being a developer at Barclays. The amount of tech jobs at non-tech companies dwarfs the amount of jobs at Google, and like Google wouldn't hire me. You know, I've worked in this business for 20 years. I couldn't get into Google. So I wouldn't get into Google. And I think that's that there has to be a level set. So when we bring people into our program, the Scholas program is grueling. It's not easy. It's 15 weeks. And then we drill you on top of that, and then we do like a 3-year apprenticeship to get you at bench with the industry. Mm-hmm. Because as much as we'd like to say, oh, maker generation, you know, everyone's an entrepreneur, the bulk of the jobs and where India and Eastern Europe and Southeast Asia is eating our lunch as a country are where all those jobs are. And they're ones that require a little bit more enterprise technology knowledge. And you can't just go learn JavaScript for 4 weeks at a boot camp and expect to go work for Google. It's just not going to happen. So I think, you know, we have to level set a little bit about the trajectory and the arc for when you're going. So our view is, let's bring those jobs here, mm-hmm. instead of and create an ecosystem that we can right. employ the folks locally.
Awesome. So, and the Startup Box also has another type of urban onshoring as well. So, James, could you talk a bit about your recruitment process and
sure.
how that works?
I agree with everything that's been said here, especially with regard to there's a lot. Well, and this is my mentor also. As long as we're thanking our mentors here on the thing, and the one thing that Keith taught us when we were starting our idea, which is a minnow next to a pretty big fish, was concentrate on value. You're never going to beat on cost, and we really, really took those words to heart, and we looked at what is in the New York City tech ecosystem currently, and in addition to a lot of those tech jobs at non-tech companies and those tech jobs at tech companies, within the tech companies, there's a whole bunch of them that are like under 40 people that are starting up in New York City. They're well capitalized, or they're working for really, really big media companies and subbing out stuff. They're dissatisfied for a number of reasons, whether it's timeline or cultural vernacular, if they have a really user experience heavy product, with the type of quality assurance services that they can get by exporting the jobs. Not many people in that niche, that sort of entertainment, gaming, user experience niche, are here at all in America to fill that. And I hope many follow and we have some vigorous competition. But in the meantime, we're taking as much as we can get to find these companies and say, hey, wouldn't you rather get this work done here? Getting the work done, though, also has to happen. You can't just say, oh, they've got a problem, I'll fix it, unless you've got the team that can fulfill. And we're not a big company. We don't have the beautiful partnership that they do, where you've got a well-established training entity that's pivoted over several technology changes and can do what a company like Doran Jones needs. We're tiny. And so when we got our team together and scratched our heads, how are we going to find people who can do this, who will work for what we can pay? Gaming came into the picture. One, because we thought that was going to be our major client base. It still is, but it's not all of them. But our now CTO, who was at that time just an advisor, Lancelot Chase, who is sitting right there in the second row, a former professional Halo player, said, why don't you throw some gaming tournaments to see what kind of people you have in the area that you might be able to work with if you're going to enter the games industry. You have to have people who love that product, who are passionate about it. And it was hilarious. Day after our Saturday space, we had a Flappy Bird contest. We went on to do other things. And the reason that's so brilliant, and I bring it up, is not to be flip about, oh, we just hired gamers. We're working in a community that's been described in ways that Majora's hoping it won't be in the future, but it is still right now, right? It's poor. And everything that being poor comes along with that, including low levels of educational attainment and higher levels of risk in any mistake you make. Mm-hmm. So people don't take as much risks in a lot of areas, as you were saying, even though they have the potential and the talent. So how do you get to those potentially hyper-talented people? And it turns out gaming crosses people from their teens into their 40s, a whole bunch of different groups that you, any group of people that you can name that would be in the Bronx, there's a bunch of them who play games. And a lot, we found all kinds of things when we started exploring the gaming market, but the most important was when it comes to risk is that this is a group of people who, if they're gonna come out to one of our tournaments, we don't necessarily hire the winners, but we like people who have the embedded experience of try, repeat, fail, try to repeat, and fail until you succeed. And that's something that gets like kind of beat out of people. If you fail sometimes in the South Bronx, you know, you're pregnant and out of school, or you're just out of school because of money, or you're in jail, or, you know, failure comes at a much bigger price here. But this is a select group of people that have a positive success experience. There's a lot of camaraderie. Online network gaming is where a lot of young Black and Latino men have flocked to stay away from the stop and frisk on the street. Mm-hmm. There's a whole virtual social space that they're engaging in for very real reasons. But that also, again, makes them passionate about the product, makes them understand the nuances. They've seen product failure when it's out there. And so by throwing tournaments, we're able to not only observe people who try really hard, we can watch them interact with other people around them. If they're playing a team game, are they team players? Because our crews work in teams of about a half dozen. And it's really important to have good communication skills. And you wind up with a group of people that end up having some don't even have a diploma, a high school diploma. Some may have been in jail. Others have like 4-year degrees, sometimes from this school, mm-hmm. who are applying for these jobs. And so educationally, all over the map. Some of them come from Scholas, and some of our people, we suggest they go to Scholas. You know, mm-hmm. it's a varied group of people that it's our job, our responsibility just to be a viable company, but also to provide this social benefit we believe in, is to collect all of that talent, manage it in a way that downtown and Brooklyn industries see a value in what we can, to get to what Keith told us, concentrate on the value. So now they don't know that they've got a single mom working for them. They don't know that they have somebody who went to prison or has got bullet holes in them or anything like tattoos that would scare them if they were actually going to hire them. But they have all of these people serving an incredibly valuable function mm-hmm. that are keeping them on deadline. We're more expensive, but the value that we bring in terms of them satisfying either investors, if they're there are small companies in the city that get like $10 or $20 million VC, and they've got somebody breathing down their neck saying, come on. So we're part of speeding up and improving the quality of their supply chain, getting their stuff successful, and then making sure that money comes here.
So James, you spoke about how do you alleviate risk for both the clients or the company, but also for you know, the folks that are entering into the tech talent pipeline that might be a little hesitant to enter it. And William, you also spoke about that Google did a pretty risky thing, you know, releasing its data, you know, about lack of diversity. And so doing that and then some of the other things that Google's been working on to alleviate that, why, could you speak a little bit more about that, in particular why other organizations aren't sort of following that, those challenges?
Well, I actually think that there are more and more actors in the tech industry who are following suit because, and just to be honest, we're among friends, or at least in a safe space. It's not because of the moral imperative. It really is a business imperative.
Absolutely.
So, you know, if you want to be a successful tech company like Google, you want to develop products that impact everyone's lives. You know, we deal in scales of, you know, millions and millions, right? But if you're going to appeal, or if you're going to develop a product that's going to appeal and be useful to everyone, you need to know who your user is. Mm-hmm. And in order to know your user, you might need to have someone who might look like your user or have the same experience as your user. Mm-hmm. I mean, we all, I think, have the experience of, you know, something's wrong in your life and you want it fixed and you realize like, oh, maybe there's someone else who wants the same thing that I do. Well, that writ large is what diversity means for us. We need, if we want to build strong products that are resilient and that are impactful, we need to be diverse, and that's what the tech industry, mm-hmm. I think, is coming to realize as well.
Okay. So I'd love to, if anybody has questions, you can throw it out to the audience. I can hog everybody for forever, but if you can line up, we need to record it, so you've got to ask your question there.
Hi, panel.
Hello.
You sound very wonderful. I have some concerns, and I want to direct my question to Varun, but I want to start with William. Mm-hmm. William, what percentage of employees at Google write code?
What percentage of employees at Google write code? I don't know the exact number, but let's say that software engineers, IT technicians, computer scientists, let's say there's 60%,
70%. Okay, so there's 40% of other people that do a lot of other things to mm-hmm. make Google successful. Mm-hmm. I just came from a meeting today with DC9, the group that does glaziers, painting, and everything, unionized people. Mm-hmm. Right now in New York City, there are $2 trillion of projects going on in construction. They are still doing many things today as they did when they built the pyramids. Over at Sandy, they're starving to get those projects off the ground, right? They can't find people, they can't coordinate efforts, et cetera. And I hear a bias coming out that technology is about gaming, it's about this, about, but sometimes it's putting on boots and a hard hat and going out there and saying to people, you know, we've got some technology that can help you. Of those $2 trillion, remember, they factor in 20% loss because of inefficiency. Mm. Think about those numbers, guys. That's $400 million that's just going to get thrown away. So if we start, and that's what my company has done, we've turned our efforts toward the construction industry. They need help. Now, worldwide, $6.5 trillion per year gets spent on construction. So just keep that in mind as you think about you, especially per Scholas, the people you want to train, where they're going, the things that they might need. Just a thought.
Okay, thank you.
Majora, can I do a quick?
Yeah, please.
So great point, and that's actually very much how we think about what we decide to train in. So I often describe the areas that we train in as the rather unsexy part, often are kind of on the top of the list, but they're great jobs, great upward mobility, and that's exactly the space that we want to be in. Telecom is probably about 20% of our placements, and we train over 500 people per year, so it's really critically important. Over the past few days, I spent some time with General Assembly, and you know, we were talking that what could actually be really useful for the field is literally a taxonomy of all those IT jobs, so that we get away from just thinking it's the coding and the programming and the gaming, but really like creating a map that actually could be used not just for the training providers out there, but for employers, for students, for consumers, so that there's a real sense of what these IT jobs are, and the spectrum is really much more illuminated, because I don't think it's terribly clear right now, and I think it's just super easy to think about tech as coding or programming, and that's not what we live, and it's not, I agree, not really where the majority of jobs are. Mm-hmm.
But in defense of my, you know, unsexiness, you know, through our program, and in a couple years' time, you know, working for us, we've got people who are making $80,000-$90,000 a year, which are great with no degrees. These are people who were security guards. We've got a gentleman who's making $90,000 a year, who was before he went through the Prescolis program, was a photo tech at Walgreens. So, and that's in 2 years' time. So it can be done. You know, that's not a coding job either, and that's a career path that he's on.
Can I?
It's not all bad, Angie.
So just to add to everything that's been said, the state apprenticeship program that Hostos has applied for is really focusing on those middle skills job, not necessarily the full coders and so forth, but what are all those vacancies? What are all those gaps that exist that other companies, not tech companies, but your traditional organizations, your construction firms, your business firms, your marketing firms, and so forth, that do need skill sets which aren't being filled today? And there's, I think there was probably close to 17 or 18,000 jobs just in the near vicinity, which were going completely unfilled because those skills were not available. So we're focusing a lot on that, but we're also focusing on is the soft skills. What are the other skills that an IT person, the techie, the geek, needs to know in order to be productive in the mm-hmm. workplace? The time management, the project management, mm-hmm. the team management skills, and so forth. So we're really going to create a ready-to-hire individual as part of this apprenticeship program.
Good evening. Cornell Green, Community IT Solutions. And Angie, I haven't forgotten that I owe you a proposal. I'm going to get that to you. I'm going to piggyback on what this gentleman, who didn't share his name, so I don't know how to address him, addressed. Within New York City, 90% of the payroll enterprises are a staff size of 20 or fewer. Now, it sounds to me like the focus here is kind of on the SME space, the middle to higher tier sort of businesses, and more established type of job titles. But it seems to me that in, as you brilliantly mentioned, we are in what I call the post-employee age, where everyone has to look at themselves as an independent contractor and an entrepreneur. What can you folks on this rather august panel say to speak to the fact, because I feel that the tech job is like the factory job of the 20th century, that a lot of entry-level first jobs for non-specific people, this is going to create an opportunity to turn this economy around. But what opportunities can be created for those 90% of businesses here who may not have a quality assurance position or a formalized position of IT, but as you all know, every business in the 21st century is going to need to leverage technology, particularly the micro enterprises, in order to be competitive in the 21st century.
Can I?
Please.
So, forgive me if I didn't communicate this better earlier, but that's our sweet spot, is those under 50 employee who are never going to put a QA person on a desk in their company because of the sporadic nature. And again, that goes to our greatest responsibility is proving value to enough companies that are in, I learned a new word, SME, today, that we've got the bulk of them that we can produce, if not a factory job, it still is a little bit, we try to be more 9 to 5, but we're realizing that we're a transitionary kind of space right now in the economy, and this is the solution that we made this year. It might look very different next year, but we're huge proponents of people who can adapt at whatever scale they happen to be operating at.
Yeah, I would just say it's a great point, Cornell. Thank you for bringing that up. We've used Startup Box for our QA at LiquidTalent. We're a startup, we're resource constrained. There wasn't a job opportunity for a full-time QA person, but we're building a tech company that needs QA. We can access the talent that James and Majora are kind of combing and curating in a cost-efficient way, in a time managed way that allows us to get what we need, allows them to get what they need, and it doesn't have to be a W-2, contract. That's not the world that we're living in anymore. So that's QA is one example that we've been using, but that goes for a lot of different things. And as people continually think about themselves as their own business, you know, as Jay-Z said, I'm not a businessman, I'm a businessman. that reality, that working world, we're going into a whole new paradigm. I mean, this is as dramatic as going from a farming based economy to an industrialized based economy. The shift from a W-2 economy to a 1099 economy is just underway. 34% of Americans identify themselves as freelancers or a hybrid of a freelancer. Did I say 53 million Americans? 34%. I mean, it's dramatic. It's going to go to 40% by 2020. It's a mega trend of the century, and it's really a lot of fun being a integral and being a part of it.
To counter that a little bit, sorry, that might be true for a segment, but by and large, the career-based technology jobs, like Barclays does not consider everybody an entrepreneur, right? And there were 25,000 people in the investment bank technology department, just in the investment bank, 25,000 people, in technology. Those are massive numbers. That's one department in one bank. Right, so and there's a huge amount of opportunity that exists in the what I call the big, fat, unsexy middle, right? Which is like long-term career jobs. Those segments are just growing year on year. The software testing industry is a multi-billion macro trends towards maker economy and boot camps. But right now, that is being dwarfed by where those jobs are, and those jobs are unfilled and there are lots of countries that are doing it, and I think one of the things that I would like to point out to kind of put on the spot a little bit because it just started to turn up is that I think the public sector, particularly around education and their use of technology, that's our money, and they hire tons and tons of people in technology, and they should be using stuff like Perscolis and hiring people come for those through those programs because the public sector could really utilize a lot of this stuff to give people a start. And apprenticeships, I'm sure we'll talk about that, but there's lots of opportunity to get starts in technology and alternative ways and straight into, 90% of startups fail, right? So there's lots of other opportunities for that. So I hate to be the, go ahead, somebody else tell me how great it is.
Well, I would like to just play the middle we're dependent on people like you and others who may be in the audience who know maybe what are the services that the city, since that is our money, could be outsourced into places like the Bronx. So we don't know enough about the city and its technological needs. I think there's an expert in the room on it now. But to be able to figure out what are those things that we could land here would be fantastic.
So I just wanted to add that don't think about tech jobs having to be in a tech or non-company.
We have to think about this
as an ecosystem. And the fact that tech can be, and it may sound like a bad word, but it really isn't. It can be outsourced to service-specific organizations. As more and more of these smaller companies that you've spoken about, they should be focusing on their core business, their core, their population, their customers. There are organizations out there that focus solely on technology service provisioning. These programs, the talent pipeline, can certainly feed into those because everyone needs a plumber. You don't own a plumber necessarily if you're a small. Exactly. So I think that as long as we have an open mind to which verticals, which scale of organizations do need permanent employment in terms of technical skills, and those which where we can help provide the skills pool for organizations which are focused solely on technology service, we'll be able to find a good mixture that'll solve all of these needs.
This is awesome that there's so many options out there. Soon, you know, hopefully the Bronx will be the place where all the tech jobs are being filled from. So there you go, but we'll cross that bridge when we get there. Question.
My name's Jacob Morris. A while back, I would say about 10 years ago, I proposed a science center complex for the Bronx. Actually, right across the street at the Garrison Playground, next to Hostos, with a planetarium, science playground, exhibition space. So a question for the panel, preliminary question. How many of you guys are familiar with the New York Hall of Science in Flushing Meadows, Queens?
Been there a few times.
Everybody? Yes. Do you know how many kids from the Bronx go to that science center? 2%. 2%. Access. I agree with Keith about the criticality of access. You knew I was going to say that. money. If the kids can't afford to go, or if the transportation is difficult. So the kids can't afford to go to the Rose Center. It's too expensive. Kids from the Bronx don't go to the Rose Center. They don't get to the New York Hall of Science. I've been saying something for a long time. Inspiration leads to motivation, leads to learning. So if a young kid goes to a science center and gets inspired, then they're motivated, and then they want to go into science and technology and math and engineering because it's a dream that they can reach and seek. For the panel,
yes.
I believe that you guys bring something to the table in regards to the shaping of kinds of exhibits and participatory type of exhibits, which is the new trend in science centers, that the children participate in using the exhibits. And I would like to see from people like yourselves helping to shape new kinds of exhibits here in the Bronx with this proposed science center. Would you guys be interested in that? That's my question. And that's to every member of the panel.
Go ahead. So the short answer is yes. Because
yeah.
I agree with you. If we want to make the tech talent look like New York, if we want it to be broad and self-sustaining, we're going to have to inspire the next generation. And via cultural institutions, just like the New York Hall of Science or the Museum of Math, you know, and there are other unlikely cultural institutions that don't have science in their name, but actually do lots of stuff.
Very good friends.
We are. We're partners, and Perskalas is actually the landlord for Doran Jones. And so this 15,000 square foot urban development center, we actually raised the money to build that out from philanthropy, from very generous philanthropy. We, you know, in 6 months, we raised about $1.5 million. And part of the reason that the philanthropic community was so excited to build out that type of space, yes, for our company, but I think Keith has wild ideas that he will share with you in a minute on how to program that space and not make it this cloistered 15,000 square foot center, but really make it, where possible, kind of much more of an open idea. And that, again, is how we really envision the partnership, that this is about leading by example, showing the community that this is real. This isn't a Manhattan thing. It's not a Dumbo thing. This is a Bronx thing. In the middle of Port Morris, across from a hot dog factory, we're going to have, and we have, an amazing space where great things are happening. That's real, and that's powerful, and it hasn't been done before.
Just to add on that a little bit, or elaborate, I think was the word. So some of the things we actually are doing already. So I did a career day over at the Melrose Middle School about a month ago, and talked to the students about technology and development, and you know how to get into tech, and gave them all sorts of great role models they should look into, and gave them some homework. And then we talked to the principal there, and we're in the negotiating with the wonderful folks at CI around actually building an app for the school to manage their schedule and stuff, and actually have the students from CI help build it in our space, and have some of the students in the middle school actually get involved in testing it. We're going to do a tech day for the school we call it the Urban Development Center, and we're going to like teach them how to test robots and stuff like that. So we're already trying to get involved in the community, because you know, we've talked about that a lot, that if it's just, you know, a closed door, great, you know, tax revenue, blah, blah, blah. If it's not a community center, we're really going to miss a trick there and make it open for meetups and all sorts of cool stuff. So,
awesome. Your excitement.
Thanks. Come on down. Good evening, my name is Nikki Torado. So two things, malarkey, propaganda, tech jargon aside, I feel like there's a huge tech talent pipeline already existing in the Bronx. So the panel, in my opinion, shouldn't be about creating, it's about enriching and strengthening that, and how do we do that? So I've spent the last 5 years on my digital soapbox speaking at conferences in the United Kingdom as well as in the United States. How did I do that? I'm not a coder, I don't write kick-ass gaming applications, I'm not a graphic designer, I speak people's language. And so with these developers, I think it's a matter of connecting them to open source tools and technologies, and how can we make their life easier. And QA jobs, I know two people that have went to Perskalas and they're happy. I don't think it's not a sexy job. Sexy is subjective. Like, some people think I'm sexy, some people think I'm not.
I was referring to myself.
It's super. Keith, you're hot. I'm sure you're going to get someone's number later. The point of the matter is that I think that we really need to focus on speaking developers' languages, speaking designers' languages, and how do we do that? Digital.nyc, IBM has done a great job with that publication. AliWatch is a cool publication. Why wasn't Bronx Tech Meetup in that publication? Also, BuzzFeed, Thrillist, the things developers and designers are reading today, they're not reading the New York Times as much. I mean, I do, but I'm weird like that. Those publications and those, we have to speak their language. And I mean, I've spent 25 years in the Bronx. I was born and raised here. I've traveled to the US and UK, and I came back home. I have an affinity for this borough. And as far as being underrepresented, if you go outside right now, there are 2 million people with flags on their cars, Puerto Rican Day is on Sunday. We're not underrepresented. It's just a matter of getting us all together for one cause. So I think we need to start with the simple things and start communicating to developers and people that are in technology that may not know how to code, because I tried coding and I suck at it. I play to my strengths. But speak to the people that we're all technology evangelists. Like, everyone has an iPhone. Everyone has an Android phone. Everyone is connected to tech in some way. I think it's a matter of making the Bronx, Keith, sexy so that people stay here, because majority of people are not tech nomads. They're leaving and they're commuting to the city. All these empty seats are developers and designers that would have been here, but they're commuting all the way to the city to go to get to work. So I think it's a matter of keeping it in the Bronx. There's already people doing it, and I'm gonna get off my soapbox now.
Yay, but thank you for being on your soapbox. And if you haven't already, you should join Bronx Tech Meetup, because we have been in it. And also, just to let you know, Sweetie Pie, Startup Box actually did the quality assurance for Digital.nyc. So we've been representing in a very big way. So I just want to let you know. All right, so join.
And we were the featured startup on the launch day of the website.
And we were the featured startup, day one.
So in defense of the city.
And Startup Box, the Doran Jones were both in Wired as well. So.
Yes. That's true. So we're getting out there.
So, honey, we're out there. We know the talent. That's the thing. That's what this is all about. So, yes, you are there. You are a beautiful representation of that. And I am delighted that you're here. Come on, baby. Delighted you're here, too.
Thanks. Wait.
Hello?
Hey.
How can you top that performance, huh?
Right?
I'm Carol Gonzalez. I am actually the president of the National Society of Black Engineers in Lehman College.
Awesome.
This gentleman right here is our business diversity chair for Lehman College as well, for our club.
Yay.
And just to let you guys know, we had a hackathon. We have had two hackathons already that involved all the CUNY colleges. And I just have a simple question. What are you guys' ideas of actually getting interns to work in your companies? Like, what would be the requirements? Because we have a lot of students who are very into tech that create apps, that create web apps, that create iOS apps, Android apps. So me having all this proof that I have the PowerPoints and everything, what would be your requirements for these students to be able to get their foot in the door as being interns or full-time positions? Anybody?
Yeah, I'm happy to address. I mean, part of LiquidTalent's talent community is young people that want internships. It's not just project-based paid work. It's internships, paid internships, non-paid internships, credit-based internships. It's something that we care a lot about and something that we want to continue to usher through our platform. We've brought on a few interns this summer. We brought in a couple of interns last summer. It's an amazing way to help us grow our company and ensure that we're building relevant products for the future of this consumer tech industry. When I was an intern, I was really treated well. I want to kind of pay that forward. I'm sure all of us on the panel here when we were younger had, you know, got some chances. I think it's really about getting your foot in the door. And it's about being hungry and motivated. It's about creating value without necessarily asking. It's about giving and then maybe getting down the road. But, you know, internships are just a fantastic way to get experience, build your portfolio, build a network, you know, talk the talk. I think it's a great point and something that we want to continue to foster more at the company that we're building.
Answer as a small company, it's really, you know, like a larger company can have an entire onboarding process, and there's some great ones that do amazing internship programs. They recruit them from college campuses. Small companies, it's hard enough for us to just manage day to day to bring in somebody that might be not talented, and us having to train them, we just don't have the bandwidth. The interns that we have today, whether it's been on the consulting side or startup box, are those people who, regardless of their level of education or their skills, certifications, or degrees, or chances of getting one, are those who took the time to get to know our business, our particular business. They don't show up saying, can I have an internship? What should I do? They show up saying, you know, I studied you in my class project. I picked your company. You mean something to me for these reasons. And I think I want to learn more about here. Is there anything I can do while I'm learning that? And so that is a completely different conversation. And it doesn't have to do with expensive training. It's get a kid on the internet and research us. It's not hard to find out information on almost anybody through LinkedIn and any kind of press that you have. But almost none, I'm going to say a small single percentage, do that step of researching who we are to make it easier for us to be able to share what we know.
I would say, I mean, one of the great things about the information age is that there is so much available. So to give you some specifics, if you want to get hired as a developer or do an internship as a developer, do some stuff on Code Academy, get a GitHub account, and just start networking your ass off. And it's really hard work, and but everything you need to know to be a successful developer, if that's what you want to do, is already out there. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's all laying around you. You just got to get out there and hunt it down and find it. And that's one of the great things about that. It's like, we struggled at this all the time at Barclays or UBS or Citigroup, places I've worked. We can't get people to share knowledge with each other in the corporate structure, but they'll go out and post their freaking source code on GitHub for free so they can get a badge. You know what I mean? It's like, so, you know, there's lots of great stuff out in the ecosystem for you to use. So that's my advice to everybody. And then network your ass off.
Also, thank you. I have a question. Would you guys like to join us in our next hackathon that's coming up in October? It's on October 16th to the 17th. And the students will actually it's a 24-hour hackathon we're gonna have. And you're actually gonna get to see fully developed Android apps, iOS apps, and web apps that we're gonna be having presentations on. So if you'd like to join us, send me an invite. Love it. Yeah. I would love it if you guys came in and saw what we could do.
Definitely. Thank you.
Yeah, it would be cool.
Thank you.
And if you have anybody that can develop in Python, have them please call me.
Okay. Hello, everyone. So I'm also a member of the Nesby Lehman chapter, and it's a pleasure to be here. I'm an adopted son of the Bronx. I've been here for quite a while. You, Miss Carter, actually spoke at my graduation in 2009.
Oh, that was a long time.
Do you know what school that was that you spoke at? Or sorry to put you on the spot. It was Bronx Science.
Oh!
Yes.
There you go.
Yeah.
Reach it. Okay.
Bloomberg was on the stage as well.
I remember.
Yeah. So since I've graduated, I went to Binghamton upstate. I came back down, back to the Bronx.
Yay.
I'm trying to stay here as long as possible if people are nice to me.
We'll keep you. Don't worry. We'll be very nice.
And
we need you.
So I actually studied African studies. I was a liberal arts major in college. And actually, before high school, I was into programming. I would just pick up a book. I would do Hello World. And then I would try to do the next thing. And then my program would crash. Then I would move on to JavaScript. And then, I learned HTML. That's one thing that it was pretty easy to learn. JavaScript. I'd learn a little bit, and then I'd reach a block where I couldn't go any further. Uh-huh. Then I'd go to animation, and I would download the program, and I would try to do something. And of course, the same story. So one thing that I learned from that was that now, actually looking back at my old self, and now I'm where I'm actually doing computer science as a second bachelor's degree. I'm not even getting a master's. I wanted to get a really strong grounding in computer science, and looking back at myself, I know that if I had the mentorship that many of the tech professionals here provided at the time,
I might have built another Tumblr.
Bronx Science dropout actually built Tumblr, by the way. So I might have done something like that at a young age if I had that mentorship. So I'm wondering, so we talked about internships, which is a really great topic, and in that, a small thing there is that, and I noticed from a lot of students I go to school with, most of my colleagues cannot afford to take an unpaid internship. Mm-hmm. So that should not even be in the discussion, mm-hmm. unless there's some sort of supplement mm-hmm. that goes with that. There's a different mindset that needs to be taken when reaching out to students who come from a background of that many of the students I go to school with do. Many of them are struggling to pay bills at home, struggling to pay for school or to even get to school. And that is something that needs to be solved. But in terms of mentorship, I wonder if people are thinking about a scalable way to provide that internship while people are in school. I know students who are good at code and don't really know how they're going to get a job, because that's not what schools are here to teach us. They're not here to teach us to get a job. They're teaching us skills, very important, how to learn to code, and literally how to learn to code, not even how to code. Literally, like the theory behind it. So how are we bridging that gap between the skills that we're learning in school and the real world skills that we're gonna need in work besides internships? I think mentorship is a great way to do that.
Is there a question in there somewhere?
Is that a question?
It is a question. So like in terms of how would you implement the 5-minute dialogue I just gave?
Someone on the panel, actually, maybe.
So, sounds like a great startup idea.
Yeah. Right. Well, yeah. I wanted to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about it.
Yeah.
Thinking about it. I got fun time.
It's viable.
But you
so I did want to address your concern about the educational approach to technology. We've recognized that here, and it's not just in CUNY. It's in most higher education institutions. And part of what we're trying to figure out is how do we become more agile in how we adjust our educational models? How do we adjust our curriculum to really meet the more practical needs of our employer partners, whether they're in the public sector, the private sector, or wherever, to make that graduate degree, that degree that you get when you walk off that platform, more useful day one, not where you then have to go and get supplemental skills just to be ready for the workforce. Now, in the interim, what we're really hoping is that through programs like the apprenticeship program, continuing ed programs, per Scholas has, again, numerous workforce readiness programs, to take your skill sets, either while you're in school, for free, at no cost to you as an individual, to really then graduate, not just with the degree that the institution is providing you, but use some of these ancillary programs to have the skill sets you need so you can knock on any one of these doors and say, I have the skills that you told my educational institution you need. Here they are. Hire me. So that's kind of, again, talking about that whole ecosystem and creating those linkages between the educational providers and the employers of the future to make you a more worthwhile candidate, because the competition's not decreasing. We all know that. So if you're walking out with anything less and you haven't done all the steps that Keith mentioned before, which is taking the initiative, it's going to be even harder for you to get one of those high-paying, high-skill jobs. So it's kind of a combination between making the awareness to all of you as future employees and the partnerships between the educational providers and the private employers.
And if I can just add, in our small way with our small company, mentorship is almost a byproduct of the commercial activity. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of how the only way we could accomplish it. And how it manifests is I hear secondhand through the grapevine in our, you know, at our shop, that some of our clients are taking our employees out for burgers and beers and checking out what they're doing outside of the work that they do for us. We don't set that up. Like I said, there's a very risk-averse, they say that you should be a mentor and you should be mentored, right. You know, because no one buys that from us, at least.
So, Dirk, do we have time for two more quick questions? Okay, great. Thank you.
Hi, distinguished panelists and everyone here today. Thank you very much. My name is Adam Lobel. I'm director of ecosystem at Sazung. My question is about team communication to solve big problems, both local and global. One of the things that I really like about this panel is that I feel there's a lot of cooperation, cross-organizational cooperation. Competition is also important. I believe that it stimulates innovation, and that complementarity is really beautiful. I first learned about complementarity from professor at UC Berkeley, Arnold Schultz, in 1998 in a class called Ecosystemology. Professor Schultz has passed, but he went to, I believe, a one-room schoolhouse in Minnesota. So all the grades were together. There was a lot of sharing of ideas. And he taught a lot about complementarity, holism, reductionism, competition, cooperation. And so I just have, my question is about what type of communication platform do we need to get this sort of cross-functional, cross-organizational cooperation on the table? How do we find the missions that need to be solved and attach the right teams to those missions? I believe I heard taxonomy of skills, you mentioned that. So how do we sort of create those opportunities to solve those problems? And basically, ideas, you don't want ideas just to stop in chat. How do ideas go into a conversation that goes into a meeting with deliverables that can be tracked? We talked about quality assurance. And so there are people from all different organizations here. And I just wanted to know from your experience, because I'm learning about this, how do we create the cross-functional, cross-organizational teams, and what type of communication do they need to solve the world's greatest problems and local problems here in the Bronx?
Yeah. If I
be email, I email with people, or I go on LinkedIn, or I do Facebook groups. The question is more, there's this diverse ecosystem. We sometimes lose the diversity. Mm-hmm. And one part of the diversities you can lose is tradition and wisdom, mm-hmm. is part of what you can lose.
So how do we ensure collaboration in
so
whatever it means?
I'll give you one example, and then I've talked for too long. I lived in Japan for several years. One of my friends is in Fukushima. He works with local traditional artisans who are restoring communities of artisans that do lacquerware. They're sustainable lacquer trees, the Asian lacquer tree. They grow them in groves. And I've been friends with him for many years, and I work at Harlem Garage on 118th. And one of the organizations there, it's, the co-founders are women, so it's a woman-owned business. They're creating a global map and tours of community businesses and nonprofits around the world. Okay. And I sort of connected them through Skype and email. But what are the ways you guys do that kind of great work to solve problems and to bring knowledge and wisdom to the forefront. Thank you.
Great.
So, to me, a lot of what I've based my training and mentoring ethos around is some work that was done by he's the professor of sociology in Wales right now, named Harry Collins, and he wrote a book a while ago called Tacit and Explicit Knowledge. And it's basically defining, you know, how much of what we know can actually be transferred via medium, via experience, and how much can be written down and transferred via non-tacit mediums. And it's by and large, most of what you can learn from people and experience can be transferred is through actually working alongside people, communicating, and seeing it being done. Mm-hmm. We'd take the I'll do it, you watch me, you do it, I'll watch you, now you do, and then we'll do it together, right? So I think in terms of communication mediums, running large, diverse, and dispersed, you know, corporate teams, you know, I've had people, thousands of people work for me all over the planet. I don't think we need more communication mediums. I think we need to use the ones we have. And one of the great things about something like Meetup, right? So what does Meetup do? It brings people together. That's an important part of this. And it's just, I think, the kind of serendipitous or luck part of getting the right people in the right place at the right time. If I wouldn't have worked for the CIO at Barclays at the time when I did, and he happened to get on the board of Prescolas, like, none of this great stuff would have happened. So it's, I think it's really creating opportunities for people to come together as opposed to trying to focus on communication mediums as more about, like, actually getting people into a room. I'm a big fan of that, but.
Right, and yeah. Just second what Kate just said. I mean, at Google, you know, we're a big technology company that operates large, humongous virtual platforms. But at the core, the nucleus of the creative process for us, it's actually face-to-face. And we design environments, campuses, that create serendipitous accidents where people, unlikely people, might sit down and dine together. They might sit down and, you know, grab a cup of coffee. And through that experience is where information is exchanged, or more importantly, where the next new idea might come from. So actually, it doesn't really happen on email for us. It happens. It happens in the hallways, totally. Or as Alex knows, it actually happens in the cafeterias because we're always eating.
At a bank, it's the bar.
a fantastic example of that is AdSense. AdSense is a multi-billion dollar revenue driver for Google. It happened over a pool game, right? These are the things that when these things happen. Salesforce was an idea that came when the founder was swimming, right? A lot of these wonderful, inspirational things happen when you're not at your cubicle. It's not at your desk, not a laptop. It's when you get off of it. You know, our technology is an app and a website, but we're trying to facilitate and foster real-time in-person connection. Mm-hmm. Because that's, you know, when you look someone in the eye, you learn a lot more than an email or a text message or even a Skype, for that matter. Mm-hmm. I will say, though, in terms of digital tools, Slack has changed the way that we run our company. It's a fantastic tool. It was built in 6 weeks. It's worth $2.1 billion right now. It's a mobile app and a desktop app that's really facilitating wonderful conversations and something that's, I think, reinventing the way email is happening. So check that out. But at the end of the day, it's really about the in-person experience, and I can't say that enough. I do want to say that conversation is going to be continued at the Future of Work conference that we're facilitating on November 3rd at the Bronx Law, Government, and Justice School down the street. We just came from there, coming into this meeting. And I invite all of us in this room to be a part of that conversation on November 3rd to talk about what does the future of work look like in 2020 and 2030, and really look forward in that Bucky, you know, viewpoint. I went to UC Berkeley, and I appreciate that comment. But please do join us on November 3rd for LiquidTalent Untapped, the future of work in the Bronx.
Cool.
All right. Thank you. It's all about the people. Yay! Imagine that. Cool. Okay, last one.
Hello, again. My name's Brogan. I'm from Assemblyman Michael Blake's office, again. And if you know the Assemblyman, he's a very vocal and active representative, so I hope I'm serving him well by him not being here. So my question actually goes back a little bit, backtracking, to intellectual and immaterial labor that you're all talking about. So we keep talking about sort of this ecosystem of an idea, and I think it's really important to be critical when we're talking about the development and the increased, you know, activity of intellectual and immaterial labor. And the fact that most of that labor only exists because of the physical labor that creates the devices and the technology that you all utilize as a platform for developing your technology. So my question for you all is, how feasible do you think it is, and what types of initiatives do you think could exist in creating quality and wage-paying jobs and labor jobs in areas like the Bronx to develop these types of systems and to develop this, the devices? Because often they're outsourced, and that type of labor is in different communities and very low-wage environments and very low-income environments. So what with companies like yourselves and organizations like yourselves functioning highly off of the intellectual and immaterial labor, but relying on the creation of devices to be able to do that, what types of initiatives can you see happening to support quality labor in the physical sense?
So you're asking if we're going to move an iPhone factory to the South Bronx from Shenzhen?
No, that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking, I'm asking what, how can you support a better work environment for those type of labor positions, being that the only way that you can function as an intellectual company is by utilizing that as a platform?
I'm going to defer to Google on that one, because I'm not, we're not even remotely close to what the kind of sphere of influence that Google can work in. But I'm not really sure what I could do to affect that.
You vote with your dollars. I mean, that's one way. You know, make sure organizations that you support are effective. You know, there's equity. There's I try to vote with my dollars, and I align with organizations that I think do the right thing. So that's the one. That's at least one thing you can do in daily behavior. But I'll let William take this one over.
Wow, I was about to say.
The final word. Pressure.
I thought there was an air of camaraderie.
See, I was just more straight about it.
The short answer is I don't know. That's it, and it's a great question. But it did, you know, it did prompt me to think about one of the things that what we tried to do to help, you know, elevate and broaden and diversify the tech talent pipeline, which is just try to affect the education system. So just a small example that we hope grows to be a big one is CS First. We created an open source curriculum that teaches middle school kids, exposes them to the fundamentals of CS. And this goes to the larger point that we were talking about creating a strong ecosystem, and that's not just rhetoric. It really does create a rising tide that helps all companies be there. The big fat unglamorous part of the spectrum or not. But CS First is a tool that we've used to try to reach kids, to show them that there's an opportunity for them here in the tech sector. And it could be here at home. It doesn't have to be here abroad, with the hope that it'll inspire them to then take the next step. It could be doing quality assurance. It could be gaming. It could hopefully be computer science. But that's just one way that we try to at least infect the environment.
I appreciate your answer. Maybe I should clarify. Mm-hmm. So my question is regarding, so we're all kind of supported, you're supporting.
Oh, sure, now you're going to clarify. Thanks, pal.
My question is, having a large conversation about development of labor that is highly intellectual and immaterial labor. So how can companies like yourselves and organizations like yourselves, with the production of that type of labor and the surge of that type of need of labor, how can you simultaneously support the physical labor and the industrial labor that is required for that, for these types of industries to even exist?
So again, it sounds like you're asking us, like, how do we affect, as if, by being an application developer, the labor costs and international trade relationships we have with China, which make the infrastructure that app lives in, or the Android phone, it there, right? And I think that is, you know, a very complex and integrated problem that has a lot of moving parts. That, you know, again, you can vote with your dollars, but you know, it's like if you don't want to have people working for pennies on the dollar in China to make your socks, your $8 pack of 10 socks at Walmart, but you don't want to pay $30 for an 8-pack of, you know, that could move the factory back to the U.S. You want to keep paying, you know, $6 for that pack of socks.
You know, I mean, there's lots of economic factors and dependencies and all those things. It's a very, very, very complex problem you have right now, which I don't think we have remotely the amount of time to discuss.
I mean, what I wanted to add to that is we're not a localized economy anymore. I think what we need to understand is that every aspect of what we do does have an impact nationally, globally, and otherwise. So to simply say that by somehow magically bringing back the manufacturing jobs that create some of these devices at the same cost that we're getting them today and making it still affordable for the masses, you have to think about the fact that that's helped give rise to the middle class. So a lot of what we're doing around the nation and the fact that there it is now a global economy when it comes to the manufacturing and so forth has actually helped this economy, has helped the citizens of this country move upward. So it's all about balance. We don't want to get too caught up into the, well, why are so many jobs going offsite? Yes, they might be, and that's not necessarily going to change. But we do have to try and capitalize on the jobs that we can keep in-house, onshore, and take best advantage of that with the different companies we have in this country.
And I would just like to add, actually, the trend is going in some industries, in the technology industry, the trend is actually going the other way. Their advanced manufacturing is actually being rooted back here, because it shortens the supply chain. It helps, you know, create stronger quality assurance on your products. And there have been some, we as a company have experimented with that, because we know that if we want to bring a product to market quickly, you know, it might actually need to be in Ithaca, New York, as opposed to in, you know, across the world.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And I thank you again. And just saying, the idea of making labor positions, like you said, bringing them back to the United States, just as attractive as an intellectual or immaterial labor position, because sometimes, like you said, companies do choose to do that. So that was sort of the source of my question. So thank you.
She said that at the beginning.
We have to solve all the world's problems right here, right now. Otherwise, we can't live. Anyway. Thank you, amazing panel, for doing all that you've done today and all that you've been doing and to support the work of the Bronx. So thank you very much.
Yep. Oh. We have one final speaker.